Thank you all for coming out on a Friday. It is probably a good way to start the term, is with a pretty casual presentation talking about science communication and looking at pictures of cats for an hour. It should be fairly relaxing. I understand there's also food after this too, so cats and free lunch. This is as good as it gets, people. I'm Jan Gardy. I'm an assistant professor over in the School of Population and Public Health that way, just over on East Mall, and a senior scientist at the BC Center for Disease Control. My work there is really all about sequencing DNA from pathogens to understand exactly how bugs spread from person to person, reconstructing outbreaks, all that stuff. But I'm not wearing scientist hats today. I'm wearing science communicator hat. So I do a lot of science journalism type things. I'll tell you about those in a minute. But together with some friends in the Vancouver area, including Andrew Troitz, your very own IOF communication superstar, we have a little group together called SciCats, the Science Communication Action Team S. We don't really know what the S is for. Maybe it just pluralizes it. Julie is our mascot. Armin is our absolutely fantastic artist. And we've got a load of really amazing people, including Nicole Ballston, who's one of the museum educators over at the Beatty. And we're just people in Vancouver who do science communication and recognize that there's kind of a hole in training materials when it comes to SciComm. We don't, as graduate students or postdocs or faculty members or community members, really have that many opportunities to engage with science communication training. So SciCats is really all about putting together some training modules on all sorts of different topics, making them freely available to the community over the web. I'll give you the URL at the end of the presentation, and doing some in-person workshops as well. And every once in a while, we'll come and do a really, really, really short talk about something, and that's what today is, a really, really, really short talk about some kind of top tips in communicating science. We could spend a half day talking about this, we could spend a whole day talking about this, we could spend a term talking about this. Andrew teaches the science communications course at the undergrad level. I teach one on the science and risk communication in public health at the graduate level. People do two-year degrees in science communication, but yeah, we've got like 55 minutes, so this is going to be a very fast overview, but feel free to ask me questions afterwards or at our lunch break. I thought what we'd do, since we don't have a lot of time together, is give you a little bit of background first. I often get the question, you know, how did you end up with the career path that you do have, where you're kind of doing science journalism on one hand, but also regular professor stuff on the other hand. So I'll tell you a bit about my career path and a bit about why it's so important to communicate science. And then we'll do three little teaser bits of material around understanding science communication. We'll talk about the importance of understanding your audience before you sit down and craft any sort of communication, whether that's a grant or a scholarship application, a blog post, a talk that you might be giving to a class or to a public audience. We'll talk a bit about how do you find the central message in your work and how can you tell your research and your scholarship as a story to make it more memorable. So I'll start with a bit on my career path. If the pink line is science and the blue line is communication and the x-axis is time, that is kind of what my career path has looked like. If I go back to the start of my undergraduate degree, which is here at UBC in cell biology and genetics, I was doing science, but at the same time I was doing some communication stuff. I used to work for the UBC campus newspaper, second newspaper that was on campus that's long since defunct as well, and did these two things side by side. You know, science was something you did, you know, in the classroom, and communications, newspaper type stuff was the fun thing you did as a hobby, and I never really saw how the two could intersect. I started to see it when I went to grad school at McGill. I did a graduate diploma program there, and because I'd worked at the campus newspapers here and kind of knew how software for papers and all that stuff worked, I ended up getting a job in the newsroom at the Montreal Gazette, which was great because newspapers get made in the evening, school happened in the daytime, so you could go to school and then go to a job and earn a decent salary. And that was there that I kind of saw how news and the media and how storytelling worked, and it was there that I realized, like, it's not that hard, I might possibly be able to do this too. So we didn't have a science reporter at the Gazette. There's barely a paper left anymore these days, but at the time we thought we were hurting because we didn't have a science reporter. So the guy that used to cover science stories would sometimes come ask for my help on things. this is kind of interesting. And word got around in the community that I was somebody that could do science-y news type things. So I ended up doing some freelance copy editing for a magazine that had just started out, a science magazine, as well as some fact-checking. Came back to BC to do my PhD, and again, it was kind of focused on science, but I had so much fun working at the paper and working at the magazine, I didn't really want to leave those behind, so I said, well, maybe I can do some of this journalism stuff in my free time. And it was as I started to talk to my supervisor, started to talk to other people in my department, that I realized that, you know, science and communication didn't have to be two separate things. They could actually go together, and science communication is a thing you can do. And when I was a PhD student, it's like 15 years ago, everybody was just, you know, carrot at the end of the stick is the faculty position, you do your PhD, you do a postdoc or two, and you get your professor job. But nowadays, you know, these days, we know that there's not that many faculty positions out there, and most of us know that we maybe didn't even want a faculty position. We want to do something different. And if you look into the latest research, about a third of graduate students in the sciences, at least in the microbiological sciences, which is kind of where I live, are interested not in a faculty position, but instead in science communications position. So at the time, I didn't know it was a thing, but these days, it's definitely a thing. I ended up doing a lot of freelance writing for some local news outlets, and after a couple of years of that, I thought, well, if writing about science is X amount of fun, then talking about it on television is probably 100X the amount of fun. So just started asking around in my network, a professional piece of advice, tell everybody in your life, you know, no matter how far away their work and their domain seems from what you want to do as a career, tell them what you're interested in doing with your life, because you never know who's going to have an interesting opportunity, a little connection that they present to you and go, oh yeah, I heard you were interested in science communication, you should meet, you know, my neighbor so-and-so, they host the science television show. So I sort of put it out to my network, like, hey, I'm kind of interested in science TV stuff, and the network eventually provided, auditioned for a CBC show, got it, and to make a long story short, if you are relatively okay at science television and do one show, they just keep inviting you back for more. So I've been doing that for about 10 years now, and it's super fun. So these days, everything's just a big tangle. I can't really disentangle the science communication part of my life from the science part. In any given day, I'm doing both, and I wouldn't have it any other way. I have learned over this process that obviously being a scientist makes you a better science communicator. You have background in the material, you kind of understand it a bit better. You can really use your research skills to teach yourself new things and find out about an area that you might want to communicate in. But what's been really interesting is seeing how much being a communicator has fed back into my scientific career, and it really made me recognize the incredible importance of communication skills when it comes to your career, whether it's in academia, whether it's in industry, whether it's in entrepreneurship. Having good communication skills is one of those things that separates, you know, the great and amazing people from the people that are really good and smart but don't have that sort of extra layer of being able to talk about what they do in a clear and concise and engaging way. So I've really come to recognize how important communication skills are to everyone. Even if science communication is not your end goal, it's not what you want to do with your entire life, it is something that you will be doing in your scholarly career, and the better you are at it, the more returns you'll see. Why communicate science? I'll ask you guys. Any reasons you can think of why it might be important for you as scholars working in an academic space to talk about your research with the public? Go ahead and shout some out or quietly whisper it out, whatever you feel comfortable. Safe space.
Because it helps inform public policy.
Exactly, yeah, informing public policy. Other thoughts?
Educates you.
Yes, educates you, provides really important feedback. Other ideas? One more, we gotta have one more. Good things come in threes.
You can get into funding.
Yes, funny, totally. So yeah, there's loads and loads and loads of reasons. You know, fundamentally, science does play an incredibly critical role in our lives. It kind of underlies everything we do. Science is in us, it's on us, it's around us, it informs our decision-making, and really talking about science makes for better societies. Some of the reasons that I think science communication is important is it's inspirational. When you can get out there and talk about your work in a way that excites people about science, whether they're young people maybe just getting interested in the sciences, whether they're an older audience of your peers and you're kind of renewing their interest and excitement and passion for a subject, that's amazing. And it also helps to inspire publics, people that might be not necessarily scientific background. It helps them to be curious. It helps to model how we as scientists approach the world, show what scientific thinking, what critical reasoning looks like, how can you, you know, evaluate evidence, synthesize things, ask a good question. It kind of teaches scientific thinking as a way of life. The informed public and policy development, when you've got a group of people that have a common understanding of the facts around an issue, complexities and uncertainties, you can take some contentious issues and really have an audience that's able to recognize, you know, what is science fact and what is sort of emotion or value judgment. So when you've got an informed public, you've got an informed electorate who's willing to go to the polls and support governments who support science. And we in Canada saw what happens when you have a government that doesn't support science, and I think you're seeing that unfold south of the border now. Communicating, as we heard, is kind of a two-way street. We get a lot of feedback on our work by talking to our audience, listening to what they have to say. We get a sense of what's their perspective on the work. Do they have a totally novel angle? Are they seeing something in it that we're not necessarily seeing? Helps us to confront our biases or our perspectives. It's a great way of sharing your work with the community that might yield interesting collaborations, like somebody's got a really cool method that might work on your data, or somebody's got a really cool data set that might work with your method. And it's also nice, too, because it kind of reminds you of why your work matters. When you're communicating about your work, you're really trying to connect it to everyday life. And that's just a helpful exercise, I think, to remind you of why you do what you do. We also heard funding. When you are somebody who is a good communicator, there are tangible returns in your pocket. That is, you know, you write that great scholarship application or that great grant application that has a really clear central message. It's got a narrative flow that makes it really easy for the reviewer to read, digest, appreciate. Those are the grants, those are the scholarships that get funded. Same when you write a really clear journal article. When the reviewers don't have to tease through all of this sort of difficult language and tumbly narrative and can instead just sort of get at the science, you have an easier time in the review process. When you get up there and give a killer conference talk and somebody in the audience sees it and they're sitting on a conference organizing committee and saying, okay, well, we need to program this session on, you know, fisheries science. Oh my gosh, I saw this amazing talk, this researcher at UBC, we should invite them to talk. So you get all of these things that look amazing on your CV, and it's almost like a positive feedback loop. The more of these invitations, the more of these opportunities you get, it just keeps increasing and increasing. And finally, I think one of the most important reasons, and one that we often seem to forget about, is that it really is our duty to communicate science. It's the public, it's taxpayers, it's people that are donating to charitable foundations and universities who are funding the work that we do. And if they just see their sort of tax dollars pouring into, you know, the scientific enterprise and churning out all this stuff that they don't really understand, they don't feel like they're getting a good return on investment. They're funding our work, so we owe it to them to be able to explain not only, you know, what is it we do, but why does it matter to them, and why does it matter to their daily lives? You need to be able to answer the question, why should I care? So science communication is obviously a very big deal, so much so that there is now an emerging discipline of study called the science of science communication. And I'm sure if we wait 20 years, it'll probably be the science of science communication, and it's just going to become like this academic inception, and it'll be terrible. But there are sort of three main publications that have come out on the science of science communication. This was the first, it was published as a supplement to PNAS in August 2013, and there was a colloquium that had been organized in Washington, D.C., gathering people who research science communication, and the issue sort of contains proceedings of that colloquium. There's a narrative report that came out a year or two later, following up the second colloquium in that series, and more recently the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine in the U.S. released a report on research gaps in the science of science communication. So there's a few places you can go for some of the formal academic treatment of science communication, but because it's formal and academic, it's fairly boring. Like here, for example, is the mental models approach to designing a communication. You know, there's some boxes, there's some plain, you know, Times New Roman text, and it's all in black and white, and it's not really exciting. We can talk about this exact sort of stuff, you know, understand your audience, find your message, come up with a really cool way of packaging that message, see if it worked. We can talk about it in a much simpler way. We can put a cat on it. And so that's what we're going to do for the rest of the presentation. We're essentially going to work through that mental models diagram, but with cats. So the first thing is really understanding your audience. We often talk about, you know, giving a talk to our colleagues or to the public or writing a blog post for the public, but there's no such thing as our colleagues or the public when it comes to audiences. Every single audience that you talk to, every single audience that's reading any material that you put out, they're all going to be incredibly different. They're not homogeneous, they're individuals, they're a unique little mosaic. Each person has their own sort of demographic and knowledge background. They're going to bring different things to the table, different prior knowledge, different motivations for learning. Really, every audience is different. So we're going to, before we get into the formal stuff on understanding your audience, we're going to do an activity, and it involves paper, and this is an activity that Andrew came up with because he's one of our sci cats, and I'll just like start sending paper around. You guys can like send it in that direction. So I'm not going to tell you what the point of this activity is. Just take one paper. You don't need a pen or anything. I'll wait until everybody has one until we start. I will tell you in advance that as we are doing this activity, you need to have your eyes closed, and you're not allowed to ask me any questions. You're not allowed to ask your neighbor any questions. You just have to do what I say with this piece of paper. We're not, spoiler alert, we're not making a crane. That would be very hard. I don't think I've successfully managed to make a paper crane in the history of ever. But. Paper distribution going inside the room, looking good. Sideways and back, we are almost there. Nobody get paper cuts. I don't want any blood on my hands today. Occupational health and safety would be very angry. Okay. Looks like almost everybody's got the paper. Okay. Pretty much everybody has it. Here are the instructions that I want you to follow. So step one, close your eyes, and there will be no peeking until the end of the activity. I can see all your faces, so I know. So I want you to fold your sheet of paper in half. Fold it, everybody. Very nice. Like what you're doing. Good job. Now I want you to tear off the upper right-hand corner of your paper. Please keep your paper shreds with you, not on the floor. I did not bring it back in with me. Once you have torn off that upper right-hand corner, I want you to fold your paper in half again. And once you fold it in half, then tear off the lower right-hand corner. We're making hamster nests. It's going to be great. Then fold your paper in half again. Tear off your upper left-hand corner of your paper. I like the guy who is ripping with his teeth. I see you have a very tiny folded paper. paper. You might not be able to do this next step. Fold your paper in half one last time and tear off the lower left-hand corner. Okay, now that you have done all that, you may open your eyes, unfold your paper, and hold it up into the air. Way up high so everybody can see. Now take a look around at everybody's paper. All of you got exactly the same instructions. Everybody in the room heard the same thing, but everybody in the room interpreted those instructions slightly differently. You all ended up with a different end product. You may put your arms down now. You don't have to hold them up for the rest of the presentation. That's a really amazing demonstration, one that Andrew came up with. It really nicely shows that in an audience, even an audience of similar background, everybody coming from the same domain, everybody at roughly the same sort of educational academic level, there are so many individual differences in one audience that we think was fairly homogeneous. Everybody interprets things differently. So it just goes to show, no matter how similar you think an audience is to you, everybody has their own unique perspective. The first time you are sitting down to develop any sort of communication, you're writing a talk, you've been asked to go out and talk to the public about something, you're giving a thesis defense presentation, you're coming up with a blog post to talk about your work or the lay abstract for a grant proposal or a scholarship application that you're working on. The very first thing you need to do before you open your slideware, before you open your Microsoft Word or word processor of your choice, is sit down and say, who is this for? Who is my audience? What are their demographics? What's their background knowledge? What do they want out of my presentation? So in any given audience, like we saw here, there's a bunch of diverse perspectives. So you've got people, for example, maybe somebody who's a new Canadian. There might be cultural references in your talk or in your presentation that they don't get. Maybe you've got an artist who thinks about things totally differently. They don't use the kind of scientific logical model, and your way of explaining something might not make sense to them. You've got somebody who, when I think about my work, which is all about DNA genome sequencing, if we've got an audience of seniors, a lot of them, when they were in school studying science in high school or university, maybe the double helix structure of DNA might not have even been discovered yet at that point. So how do I talk about something that may not be part of their educational background? We all have these different demographic characteristics that we bring to our lives as audience members that make us unique and interesting. So references that work for one group might not work for another. Techniques that work for one group might not work for another. It's also important to really think about what your audience wants. So this is a slide that I use to explain kind of how to structure a talk. If you're out there giving a presentation, you might be doing a talk at your lab meeting, updating people on your research. You might be giving a talk at a conference to an audience of your peers. You might be asked to go out and talk to the general public about something. So in terms of how we typically structure scientific talks, we usually provide a bit of background information. We talk a bit about, how we did our work, what we found, what did we learn from that, and really kind of what are the big picture and next steps. And depending on which audience you're talking to, you want to spend various, different amounts of time focusing on different aspects of that work. Your audience's background is going to dictate how you kind of distribute your content over your presentation. So in a group meeting, for example, everybody in your lab is pretty much on the same page when it comes to your research subject. You don't need to provide any background information whatsoever. I used to find it incredibly frustrating. I did my postdoc here at UBC in Bob Hadcock's lab in microbiology, and one of the things that his lab worked on was Pseudomonas aeruginosa. It's a bacterium, and Bob's lab was one of the most famous Pseudomonas labs in the world. And so we'd have our weekly group meeting. One person would give a talk each time. It was lunch hour or half hour talk thing, And people would get up and their first slide would always be, Pseudomonas aeruginosa is a gram-negative opportunistic bacterial pathogen. You're like, no shit. Everybody in the room knows that. We sequence the Pseudomonas genomes. We're the experts in Pseudomonas. You don't need to spend time on the background. Skip right to, hey, what experiment you did and what did you find? If you're at a conference, people really want to know what's the latest and greatest. How is your work advancing knowledge? What do they need to know? And if you're talking to the public, they might need some background. Why is this an interesting problem? Why are you tackling this? They want to know what you found, and most importantly, they want to know why does it matter to them? And you can think about audiences and still get things entirely wrong. An example that I like to use is Genome BC, who funds a lot of the work that I do, they like trotting out some of their genomics researchers to these Bringing Genomics Home lecture series where they send us to different parts of BC to talk about what we do. This is an event that we did in Victoria a few years ago. We had a speaker talking about personalized medicine, rare diseases, rare childhood diseases, cancer, immunotherapy, and myself talking about infectious diseases. And we just assumed, you know, it's going to be an average audience, a bunch of different people there. But Victoria audiences tend to be very educated and a slightly older demographic. And so when it got to question period and people were asking questions about genomics and health, none of the questions were about cancer, none of the questions were about infectious disease, none of the questions were about rare diseases. Everybody in the audience wanted to know about what is genomics doing for dementia research, for Alzheimer's research. And none of us, including the organizers, had anticipated. We didn't understand our audience and understand that in a genomics, in a health-related genomics session, that was going to be their primary concern as an older audience. What can this do for me, and how can this prevent something that I personally am really concerned about? So, how can you go about preparing and understanding who your audience is? This is a slide that I show in the risk communication class that I teach over in SPPH. CDC in Atlanta does these things called audience insights, where they put together these PDF documents talking about different sectors of the American population, you know, baby boomers, moms, adults over age 64, and they've got all this information about, you know, what type of media do they like to consult, what messages work best for them. So there's resources online where you can go and kind of profile an audience. Or if you're being asked to give a talk, just ask the organizer, like, hey, who usually comes out to these things? What's their age range? What's their background? What types of questions do they ask? Do a little bit of research ahead of time. So, step one, understand your audience a little bit. Step two in crafting the communication is finding your message. And that kind of has two parts to it. Why are you communicating and what is it that you want to get across? So first, take some time to think about what your motivation for communication is, because this really shapes the type of content that you include in your communication and how you deliver that content. So a few examples that you might run into, sometimes you might be asked to teach something, you know, give a guest lecture in a course, and when we're talking about teaching, the message of our work is generally facts. It's information that we want our students to remember. We use some examples to place those facts into kind of a real-world context, and we repeat those facts frequently throughout our presentation. You might be giving a talk where your hope is to inspire people in the audience, get them excited about a particular subject matter, and the things that work there are personal anecdotes, kind of telling your story and why you're enthusiastic about this and why this is so cool, and that enthusiasm that you have for your material will generally rub off on your audience and you'll get people that are excited about what you do. In public health, one of the things that we like to do a lot is scare people with our communications, but scare them gently into doing the thing that we want them to do. There's an entire body of scientific literature around this, but if we want to get people, you know, concerned about a public health issue or a science issue or a climate change issue or something, we can use alarm. We can talk about how this particular issue is going to impact, you know, your life and your life and your life and your life. And when people really see how something resonates with them, how it can affect them, that's something where they go, oh my gosh, okay, this is something I should be concerned about. So you want to think about what your motivation is in communicating and how that might shape what you include in a communication. And then when it comes to figuring out what that central message is, what that one thing that you want your audience to take away is, there's two tricks that I like to use. The first is just asking the so what question. Is the communication that you are preparing, does it answer, you know, Joe Q. Public off the street, does it answer his question, so what? You know, you could get up and you could talk about amazing, super interesting research, and you're like, we've got all this cool stuff, and, you know, we've got this research project, and we found this, and this, and this, and this, and this, and what if an audience member at the end goes, so what? The worst example of this, I haven't actually told this story in public to a large audience before, the worst example I saw of this, I still feel so bad for this person, I get transferred embarrassment really easily, last October, I got to go to the Gates Foundation and give a talk to Bill Gates and some other people. There were 10 scientists that had been invited to this kind of small group meeting because he wanted to learn about the work that we do, where we sequence outbreaks of infectious disease, figure out who coughed on who. He wanted to see how that might sort of play out in the real world, in the global health space. So he invites these 10 scientists, and all the presentations have gone super well. We all got, like, coached for months in advance. They're like, you know, don't pitch to Bill. Bill really doesn't like overfitted mathematical models. So everybody was, like, getting their talks down. Super good. Well, they had great presentations. And then the last speaker got up to give their presentation. And they were talking about, I won't describe it in great detail so as to not reveal the identity of the individual, but they were talking about a fairly boring project involving generating a bunch of reference genomes for different microbial pathogens, and they were part of a US government agency. And every slide in this person's presentation, it was very much like a dialogue-based event. You know, you'd be up there talking about a slide, Bill and his buddies would ask a question, you'd answer the question, you'd talk for 5 minutes, then you'd go back to your slide and talk some more. Every single slide in this person's presentation, Bill Gates, who's sitting right in front of him, like 3 feet away, was doing, so what? So what? And he was like, I don't understand why you're doing this. Why are you doing this? And that speaker couldn't answer the question. They had no little blur prepared to say, this is why it's important, this is why this work matters, this is why I'm here talking to, you know, one of the craziest philanthropists in the universe. They couldn't answer that simple question, so what? So don't be that person, and you will be very embarrassed if you have to talk to Bill, and don't overfit your mathematical models, but always have an answer to that question, so what? That helps you find your message, and another really helpful tool for finding your message is this very simple statement template, the and, but, therefore statement. Blank and blank, but blank, therefore blank. With your two blanks that sit on either side of the and, you're establishing some background material. You're giving your audience the background facts that they need to know. The but statement introduces conflict. It introduces the problem. You know, where's the gap? What are you trying to solve? Therefore, we are doing blah, blah, blah. Whenever you're writing a grant application, a scholarship application, a plan for your experiment, try writing this statement before you do anything else. Write your and, but, therefore. Your introduction section of whatever it is you're writing should focus on the two blanks, the first blank and the second blank in the and statement. Your method, and it ends with the but, here's the big problem, and then therefore, the cover is, you know, here's what we're going to do, here's how we're going to do it. So it's a really nice little statement to have at the ready. You can almost think of it as your elevator pitch, too, about your work. You know, what's the issue you're working on, why is it an issue, and what are you doing about it? When you're thinking about what your message is, too, forget what you know. It's often really difficult to understand what we have learned over the years that is information that, you know, we kind of take as, oh, yeah, I've always known this. It's a basic fact. Everybody should know this. But that an audience might not necessarily know. We see this all the time, even just communicating, you know, across the university campus. So I might think that if I say the word genome, you know, everybody in the IOF will understand what a genome is. Would everybody in social sciences and anthropology, would they understand what a genome was? I have no idea when the notion of, like, genome gets introduced into the curriculum. Does a high school student know what a genome is? I have no idea. To me, it's just one of those words that I use hundreds and hundreds of times a day, but I actually don't really understand what the rest of the scholarly community, you know, is that a term that's open and accessible and familiar to them? So it can be really difficult to kind of divorce what we know and just take for granted from information that is new to an audience, even if it's an incredibly smart audience. So one of the best things you can do is when you've got your central message, when you've got your and, but, therefore statement, your elevator pitch, whatever it is, try it out on people from different backgrounds and say, you know, does this make sense? Is there a word in here that doesn't make sense? Is there a concept that you're not sure what I'm talking about? Test drive your message and see if it works. Part of message also is choosing the right language, ensuring that you're communicating with words that are digestible to all audiences. And so my recommendation here is use what I like to call the party rule, which is talk about your work using the type of language that you would if you were explaining what you do to somebody that you just met at a party, and like not a lab party, not an IOF social, like a party with other people, maybe even people from outside of UBC. You know these people are smart and cool because they're the same party that you're at. But you don't know what their background is. They might be, you know, an architect. They might be an artist. They might be a computer programmer. They might be a Nobel laureate in your field. You have no idea who you're talking to when somebody says, "So, you know, so what do you do for work?" So when we're talking to people that we've just met at parties, we tend to do a few things. We obviously don't use jargon and field-specific language that we know is not going to necessarily be accessible to them. We don't use symbols and acronyms. We try and make comparisons to real-world examples, like metaphors, analogies, saying, "Oh, it's a bit like, you know, this." And a lot of times people will say, "Well, if I'm using lay language, if I'm speaking simply, I'm kind of dumbing my work down, aren't I?" And you're not. You're not doing any intellectual disservice to your work when you're talking about it in clear language. The complexity of what you do, the uniqueness of what you do, the magic and brilliance of what you do still shines through when you're talking about it in clear, digestible words. In fact, it actually gets through better to an audience. If you've got a really great idea, but you're burying it in jargon, your audience is so busy parsing what it is you're just trying to say that they can't really understand the meat of your idea, and they can't provide any sort of useful feedback. They're not getting the point. They're just, you know, investing all of their intellectual energy and kind of chewing on these big words that you're throwing at them. Whereas if you make your language more accessible, people can really appreciate what it is you're talking about. They can hear the message, they can hear your ideas, and they can provide useful feedback at the end. So you're doing your audience a tremendous service when you use clear language. And I know all of you have probably been in a conference scenario where, you know, it's day three of the meeting, you've been locked in a windowless, you know, stanky air conference hall for 3 days, and people just keep talking and talking and talking with all these big words. And then maybe somebody gives a presentation where it's kind of casual, conversational level, it's super clear, and it just sort of washes over you like this sweet wave of relief. And be that person at conferences, be the person that people leave the talk and go, "Oh, that was refreshingly easy to understand." One of the things that I think is really helpful to do is spend some time thinking about what really good analogies or metaphors for your research project might be. And this is hard. These things don't come overnight. Oftentimes, you'll kind of have an idea for an analogy or a metaphor, and maybe you try it out, and it doesn't quite work, and then, you know, a few months later, you get a new idea. But when you hit upon ones that work, they become incredibly powerful tools for helping you share your work. So when I talk about what I do in bacterial genome sequencing, one of the analogies that I like to use is books, because we can talk about the lengths of genomes, we can compare them to the lengths of books. When we talk about sequencing genomes, reading the DNA, we can make analogies to how we would read a book, different methods of reading books, different ways of, you know, ripping up the pages and reading them all at the same time, to talk about how we can do different types of DNA sequencing. So using this sort of analogy of genome as book is something that helps me explain multiple parts of my work. I can explain the length of the genome, I can explain the sequencing technologies, all sorts of other stuff using this one analogy. I also like to use this one a lot, the kids' game of telephone, where sentences get whispered from person to person to person and kind of mutate as they spread from kid to kid. Pathogen genomes do the same thing as they spread from person to person in an outbreak. So when I explain what it is we do with outbreak reconstruction, I find this simple game that practically everybody's played as a kid in the classroom is actually a really effective analogy for explaining what it is we do in the lab. So think about what those analogies might be. you can paste stuff in to readable.io and it will tell you how readable or how jargon-filled your text is. And this is incredibly helpful. I don't know if any of you have had to write for a scholarship or grant application the lay abstract for your work. You have to write, you know, your research summary that's meant for the reviewers, and then you have to write the lay abstract that's meant for the politicians to read or the people that are going to the website and seeing what all the different research projects were, the journalists that are writing about what was getting funded. And so many times as a reviewer on grant panels, I've seen people just paste the same abstract in the research box and the lay abstract box. And I guarantee you, if you put the abstract, the lay abstract of many researchers' grants into a tool like this, it would not get a very good readability score. So try some of your own writing in a tool like this. And if you want some very adorable, inspirational examples of de-jargon work, one of my favorite webpages for this is Lol My Thesis. This was started by a student at Harvard, and she got people to send in clear language translations of their thesis and dissertation titles, like if you delete pieces of DNA, bad things happen. So go check out her page and see what people have put in it. You can search by fields and domains and keywords. It's pretty funny. One thing to think about, too, in terms of jargon, that sometimes it's news to a lot of people, even people that are fairly aware of the fact that, you know, hey, we shouldn't use very big, long words that are very unique to our field, is that words that we kind of take for granted as being fairly simple words we might not think of as jargon proper can sometimes have very different meaning to the public than to members of the scholarly community. So if we hear words like error or bias, you know, those are things that we encounter every day when we're doing the type of statistical analyses that we do. But those words have very different connotations to the general public. Same thing, and this is probably the source of so much conflict in the scientific world, is that word theory. You know, for us, a theory is something that's basically a fact. That's pretty much as good as it gets in science. But to the public, a theory is an idea. It's, might be right, it's an idea about something. Maybe we're still testing it, we don't really understand. So when you talk about, you know, the theory of evolution, for us, we're like, oh yeah, the fact of evolution. But the public's like, whoa, whoa, this thing might not be happening. I don't know, it's just a theory, people. So there's a whole list of things that might not strike you as jargon at first reading, but do have this other layer of connotation. So think about these. This is from an article in Physics Today about communicating climate change. And there was Andrew Thaler that does a blog called Southern Fried Science. He's a microbiologist, and he went out and asked microbiologists for what their additions to this word list would be. So things like culture, for us, that means one thing. In the public, it means something very different. So think about your words carefully. So we talked about understanding your audience, we talked about finding your message. I'm going to finish up with a couple short words on telling your science as a story. Because whether you're writing a blog piece, whether you're writing a journal article that has a bit of a narrative arc to it, or whether you're getting up and giving a presentation about your work, using narrative, using storytelling to share your work is incredibly powerful. If you go to the Science of Science Communication Issues, you will find an article on exactly why, the science behind why narratives work so well. But the sort of TLDR version is narratives are easier for people to understand, easier for them to digest at the time, and narratives also are easier for people to recall later on. If you give people a journal article versus kind of a narrative retelling of that same material, and come back to them 3 months later, 6 months later, the people that saw the narrative version of that material have far better recall of what was in there, the key points, all that good stuff, than the people that just read the sort of standard journal article. And the reason for this, a narrative is really thought to kind of occupy this very sort of privileged and primal place in communication, going right back to our sort of cave cat days. Stories were, you know, what were shared around the fire, oral tradition, that's how things were passed on, that's how knowledge was shared. So the notion of a story is one that has this very, very special place in human cognition. So how do you find your narrative? The simplest exercise is one that we just saw a little while ago, the and, but, therefore statement. If you think about storytelling, one of the most fundamental narrative structures ever is here's some conflict, and then the conflict gets resolved. And that's exactly what this statement is setting up. You're setting up, you know, here's some background information, but conflict, a problem, something we don't understand. Therefore, we're going to do this thing. Boom, conflict resolved. Conflict followed by resolution, super simple. If you want to take it to the next level, though, there's all sorts of other narrative models that you could follow. One of the coolest ones, one of the easiest ones, I think, to apply to scientific communication is the hero's journey. And so this is something that you might have heard about before. Joseph Campbell, who was an anthropologist in the 19th or 20th century, I guess. He was going around and collecting myths from different cultures. He went all over the world, visited all sorts of different cultures, heard their myths, heard their stories. And what he came to realize is that no matter where in the world you were, no matter what culture you were dealing with, many, if not all of those myths really followed a very similar theme, a similar arc. So he said things kind of took place in two worlds, ordinary world and special world. And so you've got your hero who's just going about their daily life in ordinary world, and suddenly there's a call to adventure. Maybe they go find a mentor. Yeah, as I go through these, think about like a Hollywood movie. Think about Star Wars, Hunger Games, something like that. All of this, like every Hollywood movie ever. Want to write a screenplay, like just follow this slide and then make billions of dollars. You've got the hero, they get the call to adventure, the mentor gives them some wise advice, and then they cross into the special world where their adventure unfolds. You, as scholars, are like this. You're just, you know, having your ordinary scholarly academic day, then there's the call to adventure. There's a problem that you need to solve. There's some really interesting issue. You consult your supervisor, your peers, your wise mentor, and then you embark on your adventure of discovery around this particular issue. You're now in special world. So you've got all this stuff. There's, you know, trials and tribulations and massive failures, but great big triumphs, and ultimately, you know, you survive. You've solved the problem, you've got the answer, maybe a bunch of crazy exciting stuff happened along the way, but you're now able to kind of return to your ordinary life. The scholarship, the project has sort of come to an end, you've answered the question that you needed to answer, and the world is now a better place for you having answered that question. And then you're ready to embark on your next adventure. So the scientific method really kind of maps nicely to this hero's journey structure. And it also gives us, you know, when we're talking about telling our science as a story and using a structure like this in a more casual venue, you know, you wouldn't necessarily use this in a journal article that you were submitting to, you know, Nature or Science, but if you're giving a talk to the public, if you're giving a talk to your peers, use this sort of storytelling framework and use the opportunity that you have, this sort of gift you've been given of being able to talk to people about your work in a more casual manner, and tell them all the cool, exciting stuff that happened. You know, science never proceeds in a straight line, first of all. There's always these little detours. The more we talk about those detours and the obstacles, the more we sort of humanize science and I think help people get over imposter syndrome and things like this. When you can get up there and say like, hey, we did this experiment and it totally failed. And we did this thing in the lab, caught on fire. And then we did this thing and we lost all our samples because the power went out in the freezer. Sharing those stories is something really important and helpful for us as a community, and it makes for a good rollicking adventure tale. You know, you're in the special world and all the dramatic stuff is happening. So think about this as a framework for sharing your science. So to summarize, next time you are coming up with a communication piece, no matter what it is, that scholarship application, the talk to your lab meeting, that talk that you've been invited to give, maybe over at the Beattie Museum, think before you sit down and start crafting your communication about who is it for. Think about what's that one thing that you really want them to take away, and how can you phrase that in a way that makes it accessible to them. And think about how you might tell your work as a story. If you're interested in the Science Communication Action Team S, we have some social media things. SciCatsYVR is Twitter, and we're on Instagram too. SciCats.org is the webpage. We got together in October last year. We've been doing a couple talks and some small little workshops since March. And this month and next month is when we're actually kind of ramping stuff up. We're going to be getting a bunch of content onto the website, getting more active on social media. But for now, you can access all of the slides and workshops that we've given before. You'll recognize a lot of the awesome cat pictures. But feel free to reach out to us anytime if you want to talk about science communication, because we love talking about science, and we love talking, and we're very friendly, and we like cats, and we like dogs, too. I actually now have more dogs than I do cats, so we should have science dogs as well. maybe on April Fool's Day, we'll turn ourselves into side dogs for the day. Thank you all for coming out. Have an awesome weekend, and I'll be around for lunchy type things. Thanks for your attention.